Okay, so I'll be a bit faster than usual because, as usual, I have a very long presentation and the time is shorter than I expected. So I will speak a bit fast and do not hesitate to interrupt me if you have some questions. So I will discuss about how to set up a build farm for the kernel, but not only the kernel, for possibly other projects as well. So we'll see who could be interested by this, the context where I use this, some solutions to the issues, some pitfalls, and what can still be improved and which I have not yet researched. So who is this for? Mainly for all people who build a lot. So some developers spend a lot of time building. When I backport fixes in all the stable branches, it breaks all the time, so I have I spend a lot of time building as well. There are people who build on slow machines, like some ultrabooks, which are sold with very low frequency CPUs. It's really a pain to build on them. And various people who like to have fun with clusters as well. So basically, my first use case was for the kernel. In fact, when you backport fixes in an old kernel, you have constantly some API changes. Sometimes the patches apply correctly and you are happy. And later when you build, you realize that a function is missing an argument or something like this because things have changed. So you have to fix it and rebuild again. And sometimes they are inline functions. So you just have to backport another patch which changes an include file. And you have to rebuild almost everything all the time. So it takes a lot of time. And of course, it's important to validate the backports because when you build all kernels, there is a lot of breakage. So it's important to test them. During a backport session, I would say that the build time is what dominates the backport session. So sometimes I spend a full Sunday on it, sometimes a full weekend, and I would say maybe one third of it is just building. So the time is spent mostly between the keyboard and the chair, so it's me. but I also spend time waiting, so when you build, you have some short build sessions. Basically, you run a build, it breaks immediately. That's easy to fix, and not easy to fix, but to spot. You fix, you start again. Some medium duration, which are around 1 minute. So basically, it breaks later. And a few long build sessions, which are basically you do a make disk clean, you rebuild everything, and it's almost at the end when everything is supposed to work. But you never know how long it will take. For example, on my laptop, it takes about 45 minutes to build a full kernel with all mod config. And sometimes it's a moment I say, okay, let's have lunch now. And after lunch, I realize that it broke 15 minutes after I started it. So I know that I will have to go through this 45 minutes again. So in practice, what is important for me, at least, is to reduce the time spent waiting for the machine. Because it's easy to say, okay, I can postpone some builds if I know that they will work. But while I'm trying to fix some build issues, I need the result to continue my my work. So it's really the wait time which matters. So some ideas to reduce the build time. For the kernel, I could very well consider that I can stop testing the backports and rely on the previews, but it would not really be fair, not serious, of course. I could try to release more often with less patches. In practice, it does not really work and it does not fit my the time I can assign to this task. I could buy a bigger machine, but I already did this and it improved things, but it does not fit with all my use case, and I cannot carry it with me at work, or I will need to have another machine at work. I could consider using a compiler cache like C-cache. It does not work well for a project like the kernel, because when you backport fixes which modify includes, basically it invalidates all the cache. In fact, the cache uses as a key hash of the pre-processed file. So any include which changes anything will result in a different object in the cache. So you don't find the same result in the cache. So in the end, what remains is just to distribute the load over multiple machines. So that's what we will see here. So how can you distribute your workload on multiple machines? First, you need a distributable workload. That seems fun, but in practice, it's a real difficulty, because it requires that your project supports parallel builds. There are many projects, not the kernel, fortunately, but many projects do not easily support parallel builds. Or they have a certain level of dependencies which significantly limits the ability to parallelize. You don't want to have dependencies on the local build node. So if you have a project which compiles some code just to produce some new code, you create some dependencies. Sometimes you will need the local machine, or sometimes you may need some includes which are specified with an absolute pass, because you rely on, I don't know, an external lib or component or whatever. So for all of this, it does not work. Or, of course, you can replicate the build environment. That's what some people do over NFS, for example, when you can have the same components available everywhere. But it's not always convenient. Another point is that the build will be spread by building individual C files. So you will not build a C file on two different machines. It does not work. You build a single C file at once. You need to have many more files to build than you have machines. At least you need exactly the same number, and ideally much many more. And another point to consider, which is still important, is to have approximately homogeneous file size, to have approximately homogeneous build times between your files. Because if you start to build only the small files initially, and at the end you have one very large file, you will have distributed only the small files initially, and you will have to wait for the large file at the end. So it can sometimes even double the build time just for a single large file. So it's important to have approximately equal files. And fortunately, the kernel fits pretty well in this description. We have all of this, in fact. So that's perfect. Now, of course, to distribute the build, you would like to have multiple machines. So I will describe how to select good machines for this. And something extremely important, you need to have exactly the same compiler everywhere. You cannot just say, okay, I have this distro on my PC, I have a different distro on the other PC, but the two use the same version of GCC, because you don't know if they have the same fixes, if they have similar patches or whatever. So there is only one way to achieve this, is to build your compiler yourself. For some people, it's scary, but in fact, it's very easy. Especially for the kernel, you just need a bare metal compiler. You need almost nothing. But otherwise, since I use my cross compilers for other projects, I use CrossToolNG. It is extremely convenient for this, because it allows you to store your configurations for various use cases. And it uses .config like the kernel. It's very convenient to manipulate. It builds by default relocatable tool chains, which means that you don't care about the path you install it in. So it can work in on your home directory or in /tmp or devshm or something like this. It's not a problem. It supports Canadian cross compilers. So I know that generally not everyone knows what it is. It's when you build on a machine, for example, on your x86 PC at home, you build a compiler which will run on another machine, let's say a PowerPC, for example, to produce code for another machine like MIPS, for example, you see. And CrossToolNG supports this. It's interesting because you can use the fastest machine to build this initially, and it will work on your multiple nodes, which may be slower, but you will have many of them. Of course, it supports bare metal compilers. And something I like is, I don't have the pointer, not a problem. It supports the Arch vendor OS IBI naming, and you can force some individual fields. So for me, it's convenient because nobody cares about the vendor field in the compiler name, and I use it to store the GCC version, which allows me to have multiple GCC versions in parallel for different tests. Obviously, you need a way to distribute the build on your multiple machines. For this, you need what I call a distributed build compiler, controller. So it is the process which will be in charge of uploading the workload to the various machines, selecting what machine to submit the job, and to collect the results. It must not be intrusive in the build process. It must not, for example, require that you have to patch a makefile or that you have to modify include files or whatever, because in many cases, it will not be usable. When you have to bisect, for example, you want to be sure that you can just run the same command again and again without modifying your code. Otherwise, it's not possible. It must not come with a huge overhead, because if it loads a lot of libraries or whatever and takes 1 second to start, just to offload something which would take 100 milliseconds, you forget. Obviously, it should work with cross-compilers. It must also detect when there are dependencies on the local node, because some calls to GCC might depend on the local node. So it is important then to only build locally in this case. And when you build a farm, you may not have all your hardware available at once. So it's important also to be able to ignore unreachable machines. Sometimes some machine can hang, can die completely or whatever, so you don't want to have to constantly change your configuration. And we have something which is called distcc, which does exactly this. So we have everything we need. A few words on distcc. There is something very nice in it. It supports what they call a masqueraded mode. So basically, instead of having to rely on configuration or whatever to indicate the name of the remote tool chain to use, you just create a symlink on your file system called by the same name as a remote compiler and pointing to distcc. And you use this as the compiler. And distcc will check argv0 and will find the name of the remote compiler in this. So it's very, very easy to be able to simply switch between various versions or maybe architectures or whatever, just by changing CC equal on the make line in practice. So that's very simple and very convenient. You can also pass the list of nodes in environment variables. This is convenient when you just want to ignore one node for various reasons, because, for example, because you have installed some cross compilers on your coworker's machines and the coworker wants to use it. So maybe you don't want to eat a list CPU, and it's, in this case, you don't have to change your configuration. You can also put some limits on the number of build jobs in parallel on each individual node. This is convenient when you have different size machines. It does not use any daemon on the local node, and I find this pretty convenient. In fact, the locking is made only by files, which are called, I guess, by the name of the remote node and the number of the job or something like this. So when it bugs, you just remove everything and you restart and it works. You don't have to debug anything. And as I said, it detects the dead nodes. And sometimes, if something breaks during a remote build, sometimes it's able to restart the same job locally. Not always, because there are some cases where which are not recoverable, but most of the time it works. And sometimes it's a trap, because you realize that everything works, but it's not as fast as you expected, just because you have two dead nodes or nodes which don't work correctly and everything is built locally. The pre-processing is still performed locally. In fact, it's one of its strengths because it's easy to use this way. The linking as well. You have to consider that it will take approximately 20 to 30% of your whole build resources. So that means that you will be able to multiply your build performance by 3 to 5 approximately. By using a number of external nodes. So if you have access to a huge data center with hundreds of servers, it's pointless to use all of them because you will not gain that much. And also, there are some options which require only local builds, like GCOF profiling. I don't know why exactly, I don't know how GCOF works. When you do make all mod config, it enables it. So I simply disable it using sed like this. I put it to no, and that's fine. Everything is distributed after this. Now to select a machine, you have to be able to. Yes, Kevin.
Did you try the DiskCC pump mode?
I will talk about it after.
Oh, okay.
It's part of the things to investigate later.
Okay.
So to choose a machine, you have to be able to compare the machine's performance because you don't necessarily want to buy the wrong machine or whatever, and it's easy to be able to test. Sometimes just because you have a friend who bought a nice new machine and you come with a USB stick and you want to try. So the performance depends on a number of parameters. Obviously, as I said, the number of files to build. It will be the number of CPUs, their frequencies, the degree of parallelism. You have a lot of parameters to take into account. You don't want to have so many variables to compare performance, because if you compare oranges and apples, you waste your time. So what is important is to know what to build first. And you use this project and always the same. Since you need to have a number of files, you just pick a project which is known to be able to build almost everywhere, which does not depend on complex build systems or whatever. Basically, a workload which just depends on GCC, and that's all. Which has a significant number of files to be sure that you can test the parallelism for machines which have many CPU cores, for example. Once you have found such a project to build, you stick to it. You pick a version, you stick to it. Personally, I did it with HAProxy because I build HAProxy a lot. And when I started to do this test, I picked the latest version. I noted the Git commit, and I use only this one. And then what is interesting is to establish a metric to take notes about what you saw on these machines. And I found it interesting to note the number of lines compiled per second. So it's just a metric which is valid in your test case, but you don't care. It's just a metric you can save, and that's convenient. However, you don't always know exactly how many lines you build, and some files are not always built. So, for example, in the kernel, if you count all the lines of code, it does not make sense because you generally don't build all architectures at the same time, so it does not make sense. But I found an ugly way to count lines of code, but it's very easy. In some projects, you can simply replace GCC dash C by GCC dash S, and it will produce the ASM code, no, the, sorry, the, not the ASM, the preprocessed code in the output. And you just have to run WC on the resulting .o files. They are not object files, but you don't care. And you know exactly how many lines you have compiled. Yes, absolutely, you're right. Sorry. Yes, it's a GCC dash E, not dash S. That's what happens when I write slides without reading my scripts. So for example, I have half a million lines on this version of HFProxy, and I don't care. In fact, it's just a metric. Also, when you test machines, you don't always know if they are developing all their performance or not. Sometimes, for example, on laptops, they have a CPU freight governor, which is not fast because it's on power save mode or whatever. And what matters for you is what the machine is capable of. So always set the CPU governor to performance mode. You run multiple builds until you find at least three times the same performance level, and you consider that you can reliably achieve this, even if it involves some tweaking or whatever, but it's safe to assume that it is possible. I will not enter into all the details because there are many more tricks or hints, but I have documented this on a wiki. I will put the link at the end because it's not very interesting to have all the details right now, but it's the same order of importance, in fact. Now, what type of machine can be used for this? In fact, first you need to know what you want to optimize for. Because maybe you want to have the highest possible performance for a given budget, because you are not willing to put more than $1,000 or euros on your build system. Maybe you want to reduce the space because you would just have two U's available in a rack at your work, and you know that you want a maximum of performance in two U's. Maybe you want something lightweight. Maybe it's for home and you don't want to have noise or too much heat because having a server, one new server at home is not very, very fun, in fact. So, all of this has to be considered. Personally, I'm interested in little noise and little or no need for cooling because I mostly work from home and I don't want to have the sound of a plane reactor close to me. So another question is what really impacts performance in practice? Because if you have many friends with different machines, maybe you don't want to bother all of them to try their machine if they look similar. But maybe you will be missing something important. For example, one has many cores at a low frequency, another one has fewer cores with a higher frequency. You don't know, in fact, what to compare. So during my tests, I noticed that a number of parameters really matter, but not that much, in fact. So the CPU architecture is important. In fact, because it involves fast memory access or not, it depends on the integrated memory controller. The recent AMD and Intel CPUs are extremely powerful, really, compared to anything else you can find. It's really impressive. And then I found that ARM Cortex A17 and A53 and very likely the later ones, but I never had the luck to play with them, are very efficient as well. They are, of course, not as performant as the x86 machines, but they are not that far, and they are much smaller and produce a lot less heat and noise. Another point which is extremely important is the DRAM latency. When I'm talking about latency, in fact, the latency should be measured in the time to load a cache line, because a full cache line is loaded at once when you access the DRAM. So if you have a very high frequency memory but a small bus, it will take a long time. So it's not interesting. And if you have slow memory at in terms of cache latency at a high frequency, you will say, "Oh, okay, it will be fast because it will have a large bandwidth, but the first access will be slow and it impacts the build time as well." So you really need to find the good trade-off. Ideally, to have a huge bus with many bits in parallel to fetch a huge chunk of a cache line at once, and with a high frequency to repeat this operation very often, and with a very low latency, not to wait for the first fetch. But that's in an ideal world. The CPU caches matter as well, obviously, because each time you can fetch from the cache, you don't have to wait for the DRAM. So it's very important. The storage access time can be important. That's something you notice if you build on a live USB stick. You will notice that it takes ages to build just because it fetches the GCC from the USB stick, which is generally very slow. It's more interesting to build from DevSHM. You just copy your whole compiler in DevSHM and you build from there and you don't have this issue. And something which is often overlooked is compiler build options. When you build your own compiler, you can change the C flags you use for the target. And you can save up to approximately 10% when doing this. That's very interesting because if you need 10 machines, just by playing with the C flags, you can remove one machine. So it starts to matter.
I established a metric, a model based on this and based on my observations I made on a number of machines, which only relies on the parameters I showed just previously. So CPU, DRAM latency, CPU cache size, etc. And just by this, I managed to model approximately the performance I should achieve during a build. I'm saying approximately. I mean, it's not exactly what I will observe. But for me, it's interesting because with this model, I can say, for example, that if you propose me to test your laptop, if I know that you have only a single memory stick in it instead of two, it's not interesting to me because even a slower CPU with two memory sticks will be faster. You see, that's just an example. These are some results I obtained on the various machines. The big ones are the x86, and the smaller ones are much smaller machines. With the various frequencies, the first number after the name of the machine, it's not very visible here, but the first value is the CPU frequency, the second one is the memory frequency, and in practice, when you look closer, you realize that the memory frequency has much more impact than the CPU frequency. So I created this metric, which I called Bogolox, like Bogomips. It's just a bogus metric, but it represents what it represents. That's all. It uses the output of a small program I wrote, which is called RAMLAT. It measures RAM latency. In fact, it measures the number of transactions per second you can achieve from memory for various word size. And it's still surprisingly accurate for a prediction because I built it on very small machines, the ones at the bottom, and I expected that it would not work well for the large AX86, and in fact, it was something like only 20% off or something like this, while I expected something off by maybe 80%, but not that much. So it shows what I said, that these parameters are important, and in fact, in this exact order. So the DRAM is the most important one. The L3 cache, when you have one, is the second most important because it avoids some DRAM access. The L2 cache, when you have one, is important because it avoids some L3 access, etc. And of course, the CPU frequency is important, and the CPU count as well. But when you have a bottleneck on the DRAM, you can add as many CPUs as you want, and you still have this bottleneck. Now, how to optimize for performance? You need to always ensure that your build nodes are properly used. Because if you have many machines, but you use them at 10%, you are doing something wrong. So ideally, when you monitor their performance, they should be constantly close to 100% CPU. If this is not the case, add more processes, because you can face some network latency or whatever. It's not a problem. You just want to stuff them with some work. The local machine should not be saturated, otherwise all your build nodes will wait for your local machine. So offload as much as possible from your local machine. Initially, I used to use my laptop for two or three build processes while I was offloading the rest to other machines. And I realized that in fact it was faster to not build anything at all locally, because the pre-processing takes time and it needs some CPU. And in fact, the latency added by compiling some files delays the pre-processing of new files to offload. So it's faster to build without any local processing. Obviously, the network must not be saturated. That's not obvious, because the way DCC works, by pre-processing locally and offloading the result to the remote nodes, involves huge network transfers. So it's important to consider this. This is a real world example with this laptop here. I have a Core i5 at 3.1 gigahertz when it's in turbo mode, but the two cores run at this speed. I achieve around 70% CPU. I would say on peaks, but there are some short peaks where it can be at 100%. The build nodes are small machines I will show. They are mostly at 95%. There are some idle time as well, but when they are working, they are at this this level. So that's pretty well balanced. The network is on average at 180 megabits. So you see that just a 100 meg network does not work here, with peaks of up to half a gigabit. So that's something to keep in mind. Everything smaller will just reduce your performance. So the theoretical limit for my laptop here is approximately 6 such build nodes, because if I add two extra ones, I will be approaching the 100% CPU on my laptop. My observations till now were that the PC machines are by far the fastest machines you can find for this job. A very long time ago, I used to have an Alpha, and Alpha were much better than PCs, but they are dead now, so we have PCs, and PCs have improved. You have to fill all the memory channels available, because you want the maximum memory bandwidth possible. And by just putting four sticks instead of two on a PC, you can achieve gains as large as 50% in the build speed, which is impressive. That's not something you can easily do with your CPU. It's interesting to enable hyper-threading on recent CPUs. It works really, really well. In the past, I used to disable it all the time because I didn't like it and it was not efficient. But on this laptop, for example, I save, I gain a 50% speed. So it's really interesting. In some cases, it's interesting to overclock as well. For example, when you buy some unlocked, as they call, unlocked CPUs for your home usage, you can easily overclock by 10 to 20%. And if you can save maybe 10 to 15% CPUs this way, not CPU, sorry, but build time, it's interesting. What I noticed as well is that generally you have less gain over 8 cores just because of various memory bottlenecks. So if someone proposes you a 32 cores machine with just one memory stick, don't waste your time. However, one thing is that such machines can be expensive if you have no other use case for them. I mean, if you... I don't know, if you want to use your kids' machines, for example, you can offer a huge machine to your kids just for their games. And when they are sleeping, you reboot them on Linux and you build your kernels. They can be huge. They can be noisy. It depends. Personally, mine now is completely fanless, which is nice, but it's still big. One interesting thing to note is that machines designed for gamers, so CPU for gamers, RAM designed to overclock or whatever with huge heat sinks, you know, the ugly stuff you don't want to have at home. In fact, and of course the motherboard with everything blinking in on the BIOS, allowing you to change every possible tunable. In fact, they are very interesting for a build system. They are not very expensive because they target young people who don't have a lot of money. And you can easily tweak them to take the best of what your hardware is capable of. And you can really achieve very, very high performance number of such on such machines.
Do you have ever considered using the task affinity or even tweak the HZ metric to increase the CPU performance?
Yes, two questions, in fact. The affinity is not interesting here because in practice you want to use all the cores. So that does not bring anything. It's interesting in network workloads, for example, where you want to split the IRQs on some cores and processing on other cores. But for building, you want to use everything available. And the HZ metric is an interesting question because, yes, that's true. It's interesting to reduce HZ. I use it at 100 Hertz because you don't want to constantly interrupt your build just to do nothing. However, when you have the no HZ mod, it works pretty well as well. But I have already observed that on some machines, it seems not to work. I don't know exactly why, maybe due to some processes or interrupts or whatever, I don't know. But using a low frequency is perfect.
About the task affinity, I was more thinking about avoiding a rescheduling of the process which is currently compiling to another core because of any other activity on the system, which have a penalty cost because of the CPU RAM affinity. And if you have a big module,
okay.
Not the case in the kernel, but from other programs, sometimes you have a very big module or a very big linking, and moving that will have a huge cost.
In fact, when you're building, you don't care because all your processes are all GCC, so they are doing the same thing, they are equivalent, so you don't observe migrations. However, you said a very important point regarding the affinity between the CPU and the RAM. Because if you use multi-socket machines, it can be interesting to be able to work in NUMA mode and ensure that the CPUs where GCC runs uses mostly the memory which is attached to it. But I don't know how to tune for this, honestly.
Thank you.
Well, that's almost what we were saying, in fact. Sometimes you want to optimize to have a lower number of nodes. There are not many reasons for this, but it can be just because you're working in a company where the administrator does not want to administer many systems, and you cannot have a machine in your office. It can be because you manage to have your boss sign for two machines, and he does not know what to buy, and you have to decide what to buy because he forgot to check the cost. Oh, it's already short. So in this case, I observe that dual socket high frequency 8 cores machines are pretty fast and really efficient. They are a good trade-off. You can find 8 cores machine with up to 3.2 gigahertz. That's already pretty nice with a huge memory bandwidth. So that's a good trade-off. But you won't put that at home because it makes a lot of noise. Now, if you want to optimize for hardware costs, there are plenty of room. In fact, right now, a small quad-core machine at 1.2 gigahertz costs $8. So you can imagine that for $1,000, you could have 125 such machines. But it's not exactly, it does not exactly work this way. In fact, okay, the machines work. They are about 16 times slower than a fast PC. So you could consider that by having 16 such machines, it will work. But in fact, the machine will be even slower once they start heating, because if you, no, we don't see on this one because the CPU is at the bottom, but most of these cheap boards have, do not even have a heat sink, and they use a thermal throttling. So when it starts to heat, some cores are disabled, or they just lower the frequency. So it's not faster than, I don't know, a watch or whatever. It's limited to 100 megabits per node, but at such speed, it's not a problem. And there are some hidden costs. The shipping cost, you have an $8 machine and you pay $5 just for the shipping cost. The connectivity, it starts to count, $2 per switch port approximately, $1 for a network cable, the heatsink to avoid the throttling, one extra dollar, the microSD card to put the OS to boot, otherwise the board does not boot at all, it does not even support booting over the network. USB power supply, you end up with $22 per machine, so it's not that much interesting in the end. When using small hardware, you have other things to take into account, which is that large file will take 10 to 20 times more time to build than on your regular PC. So if you have large files, you can instead increase the build time just because of a single file. And that's what happens with HAProxy. We have two large files to build, and I noticed that on a number of machines, in fact, it takes more time than building on a large machine. You cannot have many machines hanging on wires or whatever. You will need to have a box, or otherwise you risk a short circuit. It's not convenient. It's a lot. Many of such machines are not stable. Some are sold overclocked, like some Orange P boards. They are advertised at 1.6 gigahertz and they are overclocked. Everyone complains that they hang. Very often the advertised frequency cannot be reached at all, just because there is some limit in the CPU frag driver or whatever. So that on Android, people run on 2.2, they see their frequency, they are happy, but in fact you don't run at this frequency. There is some what I call mid-range hardware between $25 and $60 approximately. They are often called small PCs or whatever. They are presented just to run a few games or as minimum machines. You can find up to quad Cortex A9 at approximately 2 gigahertz. They are quite powerful. The form factor is interesting as well. You have some good performance. It's not perfect, but it can be good. I found one machine, which is a NanoPi M3, which has 8 A53 cores. It's pretty fast, actually. It's cheap at something like $35. It's really nice. But they are more expensive than the smallest ones per board. So if you are limited on the number of boards you can buy, it's a no-go. Some of them eat a lot, like the all winner chips. I think they are all in 40 nanometers. I don't know, but they eat a lot. They constantly throttle. And very often these boards run their own kernels. So generally it's not a big problem, because when you build your farm, you don't care really about the kernel. But when you start to see some network losses or whatever and you want to fix the Ethernet driver, then you realize that their kernel is completely bogus and it's not possible or not easy to update it. You don't want to enter into this game. Then there are what I call the high-range hardware in this area as well. They are often sold as set-top boxes for video playback or whatever, from $50 to $200. This is where you find very interesting machines. 4 to 8 powerful cores at 1.5 to 2 gigahertz. Some examples are the Mickey board, Rico Magic V5, and one of its clones, which is called CS08. Which is a crap, by the way, but powerful.
You're speaking about ARM platforms, but they are not to be able to sustain any workload at the same time. I think the memory IOs at the same time as CPU computation at the same time as CPU.
In fact, the A17 and A53, yes, they are really powerful. Really. In fact, I observe that's what is written here. a single of these boards achieves one quarter of the performance of my home PC, which is a Core i7 at 4.4 gigahertz. So it's not that bad, actually. I just need four of them to equal this performance. Often, yes. Actually, it is. In fact, it was sold at 2 GHz, but it's not 2 GHz, it's 1.5. I thought the vendor was cheating, but apparently they did not even realize themselves. no, but it's very frequent because when vendors use CPU makers BSP, there are a lot of hacks in them and they don't realize what happens. This board is very interesting for one thing. It's moderately powerful, but it does not heat at all. And when you want to build a large farm, it's very interesting for this.
Since I'm working on the maintainer for the analogic chips upstream, that device now with Linux next today will actually run the
analog. Good.
Enough to build. It doesn't display your stuff, but not to build.
Exactly. We'll be quick. Yes, some of them come with gigabit connectivity, which is nice. You have some onboard storage, so you don't need to buy an SD card, which is, by the way, very slow. Some of them are supported in mainline. The Mickey is supported in mainline, so the Android C2 as well now. Often they are sold, not all, but some of them are sold on Android. So it's not always convenient to port if it was not planned to be sold as Linux. But sometimes you can manage to find your way on it, root them and install a chroot with Linux inside. That's enough to run a GCC. But it does not always work due to SC Linux, which rejects, which prevents you from binding to listening ports. So I failed on some machines just because of this, and that's why I managed to finally reroute them. You have some varying build quality. Some CS08 clones are were sold with fake RAM chips and whatever, or when they hit, everything hangs on it. The software is crap on all the cheap ones. So if you are not able to reinstall the software yourself, you are wasting your time. In fact, it's nice to learn how to root such machines and to find your way. It's really nice stuff. But if you just want to build, to set up a build farm, you're wasting your time. The power draw, the advertised power draw is often lower than the reality. You will not hit your wires, but when they say that you need a 2 amps power supply, you have a 2 amp power supply and you realize that the board constantly freezes because your power supply should have been 3 amps. And of course, thermal throttling as well. In fact, it's very simple. If you see a board sold without a heatsink, you don't buy it. You're wasting your time. My personal choice, in this order of choice, is a Mickey board first. It's very, very cheap and extremely fast. It has a 64-bit DDR3 memory. That's really nice. The NanoPi M3, it has 32-bit, but still very fast. It has 8 cores, so it compensates a bit. The Android C2 is quite fast, but as you see, it's only 2/3 of the Mickey. So when you want to build a build farm instead, it's more interesting to use the Mickey right now. And the other ones, the HDMI sticks, they are reasonably powerful, but not very reliable. So that's what I built. My first version is here. You see, it's a bit of a hack. Okay. Actually, they are these things. Okay. I want a photo, Jonathan. That's it. Okay. And when you open them, you find this inside. So you have the CPU, the rock chip, you have the Ethernet port, some RAM here, the flash, some Wi-Fi, which I don't use, HDMI, which I don't use. In fact, for me, it's just a point to solder some large copper block just to maintain them together. It heats quite a lot, but it's reasonable. As you can see, it's more visible on the photo. I have added some reasonably sized heat sinks, and they work pretty fine this way. As I said, the hardware is crappy, so sometimes they hang, but I don't care. I know that there are other improvements. I can quickly show... I don't see it here. I have to move the window. Make all config. The said to disable GCOV. Okay. And what else? Make, for example. No. Where is it? This one. Maybe it will hang because sometimes they do. If it does, it's not a big problem. I will run, remove all the windows over there. You see the CPU usage per board. It's just VM stat. Well, it's hard to move with the delay. Wow. Difficult. And the local node for now it's completely idle. That's strange. No, okay. Anyway, just a demo. You can see that they are all. No, not this one. I don't know why. Oh, it hanged. You see? Okay. But by the way, even so, it hanged. You see that it continues to build. This TC has noticed that it does not respond anymore, and it's continuing the build on the other nodes. So you need some high quality hardware, to be honest. This one is crap, but it's interesting to, for the experiment. Yes, I did. But in fact, Ah, super. on this format, you only find atom boards, and the atom is pretty slow. In fact, it's two or three times slower than these CPUs for the same power draw. For this workload, I insist on this. Something to consider, many of these boards are sold with a huge GPU inside, and in fact, the thermal design is usually planned for the GPU, but since you don't use the GPU, in fact, you don't care. So it's quite common to be able to build, even sometimes to overclock the machine, just because you have some thermal edge room. So that's pretty nice, in fact. Wow. I don't know. Some blood. I don't know who I killed. What else? Okay. Just to give you an example, my laptop builds the whole mod config in 43 minutes, and on this farm, when it works, in only 14. So I managed to build the latest 3.10.103 kernel on this one for various architectures, and it saved me a lot of time. And the last two versions of the kernel we built for our load balancer were built on this one as well. So actually, when it works fine. I will quickly finish with a few points. Some areas to investigate later. Use the pump mode of this TC. The principle is that this TC sets up a local HTTP server to deliver some the include files. And I'm not even sure it's HTTP actually. I don't know. Maybe you know, Kevin, no? I thought it was, but I have a doubt now. Anyway, so, but it's a file server. And the remote nodes connect to it to retrieve the include files. I don't know if it works well for the kernel or not. I have no experience with it, but it's definitely something to consider because it would remove the local preprocessing time, which allows you to scale even larger. I thought about using HAProxy in front of this CCD of the demands. In fact, there is a reason behind this. I noticed that the load is never well balanced. And when you have only one CPU, one job on a machine and four jobs on another one, you are wasting the memory bandwidth because it's not completely used on a machine and saturated on the other one. And it's interesting to be able to exactly balance the load to have the lowest number of processes per node when you can. I thought about trying to remove this small switch by using Wi-Fi, for example, since there is Wi-Fi on board, but the bandwidth is not compatible. However, maybe with LZO it could be doable, but because the DTC supports compression, but it will also take some CPU time on the local and the remote nodes. So there is possibly a trade-off here to find. And similarly, I thought about a USB net on the OTG port because there is an OTG port. I have never tried it. It could be an option with a USB hub, especially since some power supply come with a USB hub. I said most of this. You don't need a large distro for this. You can put any distro. You put everything in DevSHM. As long as you have some memory, you don't care. Always monitor that there is no CPU hog on the system. When you reuse such systems, it's very common to see X running in loops because you have nothing connected to the HDMI port or systemd using one full core for no reason, for no apparent reason at least. And you need to get rid of this before doing your measures. The Core i7, the unlocked versions of the Core i7 are very interesting. Because you know that each core can achieve a higher higher frequency individually, but normally not all of them together. And with the unlocked versions of these CPUs, you can force all the frequencies. And you know that each core will support it, so you can actually put your CPU under stress at all cores at the max frequency and get a very high performance. The Xeons are not really interesting. They are slightly more powerful than the Core i7 in terms of memory bandwidth, but they have lower frequencies and are much more expensive. The atoms are really too slow, so all of these are too expensive for what they can achieve. And I find that the sweet spot is in Cortex A17 or A53 because you have... I would say half of the performance of a very high-end PC for a tenth of the price or something like this. It's very interesting. And it does not make any noise, and I can even carry it in my bag. And you can actually think about daisy chaining when you put this on your desk. You can daisy chain such clusters. On an 8-port switch, you can have your PC connected to one port, six nodes, and the network on the other one. So it's easy to plug even if you have a single cable. Or if you pick a 5-port switch, you just have three nodes, but you can daisy chain them behind each other. And that's all. So here are some links, links to the various boards which were featured, and the wiki with all the experiments. And CrossTool NG DCC. And that's all. Any questions? I'm late, as usual.
Were you building x86 kernels? You have x86 cross compilers on the.
Yeah, absolutely. That's what I'm doing. I do x86 and x86-64. I sometimes do others as well, but these are the ones I test the sweetened kernel with.
Compared to the...
Yeah.
Compared to the 45 minutes you announced that your build time without this build farm, what time do you achieve?
14 minutes.
14?
14 instead of 45. Exactly. That's nice, actually.
Yeah.
Hmm?
So, wow.
Excuse me, sorry? Good question. These boards, when they're fully loaded, they're at around 7.5 watts. And when I overclock them slightly, I can reach 10 watts. And when I overclock hardly, they reach even 17 watts each. But at the, well, they are starting to eat up. When they are at the regular frequency, you realize that everything included, you will not go beyond the 50 watts of the power supply anyway. So that's... I don't know how much my laptop consumes when it's building. I have not measured. At least what I know is that my laptop has a fan which makes a lot of noise, so it's doing something. This one does not make any noise at all, so I guess they're consuming less. There is such such discussion on the wiki. That's why I didn't want to enter into the details, because there are many possible combinations. You have the lines of code per second per watt, the lines of code per second per dollar, etc. And you have to find what is relevant to your use case, in fact. No. Sorry, fini toi avec la porte, vas-y. Sorry. Just because I don't like to have noise in the place I work for. So this one makes absolutely no noise at all. They are pretty convenient and I can bring them at work. The day I have some build servers at work and similar build servers at home, maybe I will use different boards, but this one they match my use case. And that's the important point. You have to find some hardware which matches your use case. More question? Ah, Constantin? Wow! I don't know. In fact, for me it's convenient to build where the code is. When you have just an ADSL line, slow performance ADSL line, it's not convenient to constantly upload and whatever. When you are backporting, I have never counted, but maybe I build 100 or 200 times sometimes, you see, on a session. So even just the upload time can start to count there. I don't know. It's a good question. I don't know, to be honest. I see. In fact, maybe it's interesting for the final build, because I always do a final phase before posting the preview, because I want to be sure that people will not complain that I broke the most obvious build. And this is the one which is supposed to work and which takes time. So normally after this one, I do not have to upload again and again. So maybe it could be useful for this one. Hmm? Yeah, okay. Fine. Okay, so that's all. No, microphone, please. Ah, that's an excellent question. Possibly that it would work. But you see, that's the principle of these experiments. You have to count the use case, the usage, the CPU usage, etc., and you see if it works well or not. Don't know. Something we can discuss. Just a quick note. We built 4,000 modules in just 12 minutes with the 3 machines. No, I did mine because I did not know exactly what existed for this. And in fact, it started with a modification on the final tool I used to have in the past. And I thought, oh, I could probably modify it just to measure at a different word size. And it started like this, in fact. But it's very small. It's very simple. It's a few tens of lines. Okay. Okay, so now that's all. I'm late.